my great pleasure to introduce someone who needs no introduction, but that won't stop me from talking. I am, of course, referring to Sara Schneider, and it's a real treat that we have today, because Sara will be sharing us kind of an overview of what is captured in beautiful detail, elegant prose, in her book, which she wrote. Actually, we're selling these books at half time and after the concert. Sara will be doing the signing, and all proceeds for that will be going to the cathedral music project, for which we thank Sara very much. So, quickly referring to my notes, which I forgot to look. So what we have today is a kind of a gripping story, very fraught of love. Swinging to a new love, and then ultimately rejecting that. And I'm not referring to the book, I'm referring to Sara. And as many of you may have seen, she once had a license plate that said, "Books to Buddha," a man she revered and loved deeply. She went to Lübeck to research the book she was going to dedicate. And there she meets Max and just falls madly in love. He's an emperor, he's good looking, he's got, you know. So she ditches Books to Buddha, writes a book on Max, and you think that this would be happening ever after, but now her license plate says, "Oh, crap." She dumped Max. So this self-described Jezebel will now get us. Will now give us a talk about Max, the itinerant emperor of the Holy Roman Empire.
Thank you all so much, and unfortunately, I'm not embarrassed at all. Thank you. I'm so pleased to see you all here. I know there's a lot going on. This entire weekend, but you all made the right choice, in my opinion. So, and the music, I heard it last night, it's phenomenal. So we're all in for a super treat. So we are going traveling with the Emperor, and we'll visit some of the places that were most important to him, towns like Innsbruck and Augsburg. He also visited the Low Countries, which I'll tell you about. And as Anthony mentioned, Maximilian was an itinerant ruler, like many medieval kings and queens. They traveled around to essentially show their face, show the people who was boss, interact with their subjects, and just generally display their pomp and power. So who remembers that meme that was going around about, I don't know, 5 years ago? It went something like, "What my mother thinks I do, what society thinks I do, what I actually do." So here's a variation on that. Yes, traveling was definitely no picnic in that time period. And so the first image, the very fancy chariot that we saw, that came from a huge, just magnificent, one of his artistic projects called the Triumphal Procession, which was a series of woodcuts, and all told, it's about 177 feet long. And it even showed Maximilian's musicians, several of the carts or floats or whatever you want to call them. And that's also what we're talking about today, because he took his musicians everywhere, even on his military campaigns. So I'll tell you more about that. So he traveled around like a medieval ruler, but in other ways he was actually quite modern. So transition from the medieval period to the early modern era, or Neuzeit, as they call it in German, happened on Maximilian's watch, and historians get his message and his, the image he wanted to project out there to the people, and that medium was print. And we'll see some examples of how he used that in just a bit. He was born in a little town near Vienna called Wiener Neustadt on March 22nd, 1459. And his parents were Holy Roman Emperor Friedrich III and Eleanor of Portugal. And so his first journey, and in many ways one of his most important journeys, happened way before he was emperor. He was still archduke at that time. An 18-year-old kid from the sticks, who traveled into the Low Countries to marry his bride, Mary of Burgundy. And I'll show you a map of the Burgundian territory as it stood during the reign of Duke Charles the Bold, who was Mary of Burgundy's father. That is modern-day Netherlands, and then underneath you have modern-day Belgium. That is the territory of Burgundy as we now know it in France. And so that entire orange section that you see there was Burgundian territory. So the fact was that even though Frederick III was the Holy Roman Emperor, his court was not really very influential and it wasn't very wealthy. And so young Maximilian found himself going to one of the glitziest wealthy courts in all of Europe. So Mary of Burgundy was Charles the Bold's only child, and she was one of the most eligible bachelorettes in all of Europe. And what Charles the Bold was hoping would happen was that Emperor Friedrich, who negotiated this marriage, would elevate the Duchy of Burgundy into a kingdom so that he could wear a crown and call himself the king. And in many ways, Charles the Bold represented the ideal ruler for young Maximilian, way more than his father, actually. And so it's little wonder that he later modeled himself after the example of Charles the Bold and modeled his musical establishment, the imperial Hofkapelle, after the Burgundian court chapel. Charles the Bold loved music. He was actually a composer himself. And I'll read a little quote from a chronicler named Olivier de la Marche, and this is from his chronicle of life at the court of Charles the Bold. "And when the Duke has labored all day at his duties and given audience to everyone, he retires to his chamber, and the squires go with him to keep him company. Some should sing, some should read romances and other arresting things. Some should speak of love and arms and help the prince pass his time in gracious diversions." So unfortunately, Charles the Bold died in battle in January of 1477. So he did not live to see his marriage plans for Mary come to fruition. The marriage did go ahead, however, and that was largely due to Mary's determination. So once Charles died, she was suddenly under pressure from a lot of people, from a lot of different sides, to marry various other people. There was a candidate from England. Also, the Dauphin of France was a favorite partner, but she stuck to her guns, and she said, "I am not in a position to marry anyone except the emperor's son." So by all accounts, Maximilian and Mary really did love one another, even though it was an arranged marriage. They had a lot in common. They both loved hunting, music, and games. And the story goes that when they first met, they didn't even share a common language. But then that Maximilian quickly learned both French and Flemish, the languages that were prominent at the court of Burgundy. I have the feeling, though, that they could probably make a pretty good go of communicating in Latin, which Maximilian certainly spoke, and I'm almost positive that Mary spoke it as well. But that is straight from the speculative history department, so take that with a grain of salt. Philip the Handsome and Margaret of Austria, and we'll actually be hearing some of that music this afternoon by composers like Anton Brumel and Pierre de Rue. So, very sadly, Mary of Burgundy died after only 5 years of marriage as the result of a hunting accident. But Maximilian kept her memory alive in his all of his vast art projects, most notably his literary works, Weisskönig and Teuerdank. Weisskönig is a very, very fictionalized autobiography of the emperor. He also kept her memory alive by at least attempting to reclaim some of the territory which had formerly belonged to Burgundy. And here's a quote from a book about the composer, Pierre de la Rue. The book was written by Honey Maconi, and it illustrates the point that Maximilian took his musicians pretty much everywhere with him, even on his military campaigns. And I quote, "In 1492, he began a campaign against France in Franche-Comté, which was adjacent to and formerly owned by Burgundy. Having the chapel with him may have appealed to Maximilian for symbolic reasons, and perhaps he was aware that Charles the Bold had traveled with musicians. It certainly accorded with the standard royal desire to put on a good front for the outside world, and the chapel's 20-odd members, possibly augmented with some of Maximilian's German musicians, would have provided a show of worldly wealth that would help belie the actual financial straits in which Maximilian, as usual, found himself." End quote. And I'll tell you more about Maximilian's empty pockets as we go along. Emperor Maximilian loved the town of Augsburg, Germany, and he was there so often that they nicknamed him the mayor. And in the summer of 1518, he convened a very important political convention, if you will, called the Reichstag. That's what they call it in German. In English, it's usually translated as imperial diet. Now, there were a couple of important things on the agenda, but paramount for Maximilian was the election of his grandson Charles as the next emperor. Now, I hear you saying, wait a minute, emperors were elected? And the answer to that is yes. They were elected by a group of nobles called the electors. And if you've ever heard of like the Elector of Saxony or the Elector of Brandenburg, it's those guys. And trust me, money changed hands in order to sway these elections, shall we say, at a rate that would make Washington politicians blush. Or maybe not, but there was a lot of money, a lot of other, you know, gold and riches and tapestries that changed hands so that people would vote for the right candidate. And that's one of the really interesting things about imperial politics, you know, from my opinion, from my perspective. These electors were wealthy princes in their own right, and they often thwarted Maximilian's aims, and in fact, he called himself a king of kings for that very reason. So, Maximilian spent a bunch of time and money at the Diet bribing people to vote for Charles, and he succeeded because his grandson became Emperor Charles V. So I mentioned Maximilian's cash-poor existence, so how could he afford to bribe all of these electors? Enter Jakob Fugger. He was an Augsburg merchant banker who was so rich that if he lived today, somebody actually did this calculation, he would be worth something like $328 billion. Move over, you not must. So he essentially funded the election of Charles. And here's a great example of what I mentioned earlier about Maximilian using the technology of printing to get his point across, to have everyone see the image that he wanted to project. This is a woodcut by Hans Seitz, which dates from 1518, the year of Maximilian. Maximilian's last imperial diet. And I think that this was printed and distributed at the diet to consolidate Maximilian's authority and also to show his close relationship with the Pope, Pope Leo X, who was born Giovanni de' Medici. And if you see at the top, that is the Medici coat of arms, which is topped with the papal crown, and it's flanked by Maximilian's two coats of arms, the imperial crest on the left, and then on the right is was the crest that he had as King of the Romans. Maximilian's musicians are also prominently shown here. Singers on the right, they're all standing around a large music stand with a huge volume of music. Ludwig Zenfel, whose excellent music we're going to be hearing this afternoon, he's definitely in there somewhere. We just don't know which one he is. And then, left, we have Maximilian's famous organist, Paul Hofheimer, who also worked for the Fugger family. And he is playing a very interesting instrument called an Apfelregal. It's a little reed organ that has a very strident sound. So it's an apple regal, and it's named because those resonators kind of resemble apples. So when I was writing The Eagle and the Songbird, it was very important to me to sort of stick to the facts as they are known about Maximilian's life. So the timeline, the facts of his life, Ludwig Zenfel's life, as far as we know, not too much is known about him, but I wanted to base that as much as possible on reality. Then you have the character of the Songbird, a female court musician named Catherine DuCroy. She is entirely made up, but she was based on a real person, a real musician that Maximilian encountered. And I have a quote here from another court chronicler named Jean Molinet, and he describes what heard on that day. And I quote, "He was entertained at supper by a young lady of 20 years who was the best singer and instrumental performer anyone had yet heard. For the diversion of the Archduke, Maximilian, she performed alone chansons and motets, singing and playing on the lute, harp, rebec, and harpsichord. All of this was accomplished so melodiously, with such artifice and rhythm, that she seemed more angel than human being." End quote. And voila, the Songbird was born. And I don't want to get too many spoilers away, but there is a chapter in the book where, again, Maximilian wants to look really good in this imperial diet, and so he wants his court chapel, the Hofkapelle, to have a special sound. So Catherine dresses up like a man, stands up there with the singers, and blows them all away. This was a the opening mass of the imperial diet. And so would that have actually happened? Probably not, but I read once that the starting point of fiction is to ask what if. And so that was my what if. And according to Molinet, again, Maximilian searched for the most experienced musicians, having the most harmonious and well-proportioned voices that it was possible to find. And again, since his financial means were limited, music was a way for him to cut a good figure in public, and especially on weighty occasions like the diet. And another notable occurrence happened. Here we have a female lutenist. I always forget about this slide. I did not base Catherine on this particular painting, but I just wanted to show you this lovely lutenist, and there were absolutely professional female musicians working at courts in the Renaissance. Okay, another notable occurrence at the imperial diet in Augsburg was the fact that Maximilian got sketched by probably the greatest German Renaissance artist, Albrecht Dürer. And Albrecht Dürer would take this sketch, and then he would create a series of woodcuts, woodblock prints, and at least two portraits. And so this image has largely shaped Maximilian's posthumous image, up to and including the promotional materials for this concert. So moving on with our travels with the emperor, one place that Maximilian really wanted to visit but never quite got there was Rome. And he wasn't there to sightsee. He wanted to be crowned by the Pope in Rome, like every other Holy Roman Emperor since Charlemagne. And he was all ready to go, but then there was this political situation happening in Italy that the ruler of Venice, the Doge, would not allow him to pass through territory because the Doge was fighting with the then Pope Julius II and his all of the mess. So no Roman coronation for you, Maximilian. So he had to make do with being crowned in Trento, which was in his own territory. It was in Italy, but it was in Holy Roman Empire territory. But if Maximilian had made it to Rome, I am positive that he would have had one of the pieces on this concert today at his coronation, and that is the exquisite motet by Heinrich Isaac called Virgo Prudentissima. This is a real showstopper. It is scored for 6 parts. It's been called a musical monument to Maximilian's imperial ambition. And if you know the excellent English group, the Talis Scholars, their director, Peter Phillips, calls it a piece with a grandeur that no other Renaissance composer could rival. And that is a big statement because Heinrich Isaac's generation was complete with big talent. I mean, people like Josquin, people like Jakob Obrecht. So, of course, Isaac manages all this grandeur very skillfully by changing the textures, by changing the tempos, and of course working up to a really big finish at the end. And towards the end of the piece, the text offers prayers and entreaties for Maximilian the Emperor. And of course, at that point, Isaac puts the brakes on the polyphonic texture where the voices are all doing their own thing. He scores that part of the text homophonically, so all the voices are together, so that Maximilian's name really pops out. And that was, of course, the Renaissance music equivalent of seeing your name in lights, and Maximilian would have felt all proud of himself. And if there's one place on earth where Maximilian's memory still burns brightly, it is the town of Innsbruck. And I got to go there twice while I was researching the book, and oh my gosh, I love that place. But the best part for me was, if I happen to make conversation with just a random person on the street, and they're like, oh, look at this strange American, what are you doing here? And I would say, you know, researching this book about Emperor Maximilian, they would not even blink. They would start telling me stories about his life. So he still lives, he definitely lives out there. And his memory is everywhere in Innsbruck, from the iconic golden roof, which he built to celebrate his second marriage to Bianca Maria Sforza, to his magnificent cenotaph in the Hofkirche court church. So the tomb is empty, but he is surrounded by 28 larger-than-life bronze statues. And these were people, you know, they included his loved ones, like Mary of Burgundy. His parents are included there as well. Also just people he admired, like King Arthur of England. And he's actually buried in the town he was born in Neuschwanstadt. But this cenotaph is undoubtedly one of the most impressive pieces of his memorial. It wasn't completed until long after his death, but many of those gigantic statues were both designed and cast during his life. And like all of his artistic projects, he was he was right there to supervise all the details. One might easily say that he micromanaged these artistic projects. So what was so special about Innsbruck for the emperor? Well, it's located in the region Belgium as a territorial prince. The landscape there is still just absolutely gorgeous, and he was a great outdoorsman who loved to hunt and fish. It was also rich in natural resources. In fact, he called it his bottomless purse. Unfortunately, it wasn't bottomless. He practically bankrupted Tyrol in his efforts to get Charles elected. And in fact, after that imperial diet in Augsburg, he went straight to Innsbruck, and with his whole retinue, you know, a couple hundred people. And he had left behind so many debts from previous visits that they essentially turned it away. They refused to give hospitality to his people. They refused to stable the horses. So he had to turn right around and leave again. And I can only imagine how bitter that must have been to be turned away from his very favorite city. So this is one of Maximilian's most famous quotes. It's from that fictionalized autobiography that I mentioned earlier, Vice Queen. And one of the sources I read about Maximilian referred to what he wanted was not simple remembrance, but rather an enduring presence on earth after his death. And he certainly succeeded in that aim in towns like Augsburg and Innsbruck, and for this weekend, right here in Austin, Texas, too, thanks to Texas for the Music Project. So enjoy.